other senses, the word party can mean a cocktail party or a political party. And we invited this exceptional group of artists who are going to perform and share their work with you tonight to respond to a very simple question.
What is your dream party?
So here now are their responses. Thank you for coming.
Y'all ready to ride? We got Phillip Howze coming up soon. Is this Phillip Howze? Okay. Here we go.
Thank you. Thank you all for the being in the book. Thank you very much. Coming up next, we got Jaclyn Backhaus. Yes! Come on down.
Hey y'all, I would love for everyone to get up and join me in the floor area here. Start out. Hey y'all, so let's have everyone take a cup. Compostable cup and pass it. How about we'll start here. You can take a pass. Yeah, actually, you want to take this and pass it?
Hey.
All right. Oh, everyone got. Does everyone have cups?
We need a cup over here. Okay.
I'll take a cup.
We need a cup. Great.
Here, ready?
You got one?
Okay. Ready to unload it.
Here, I'll take this one. Marcus, you got a cup? Great. Okay. So let's divide the room into wine over here and seltzer over here. Whatever you want to
call your Okay. The wine is natural, just so you know, the wine is natural, and the seltzer is LaCroix.
Well, okay, yeah, we're good. This is an expected ratio.
Okay. So, my name is Jaclyn Backhaus. We're gonna fill your cups while I talk. I don't know.
Can you all hear me if I like talk louder?
Yeah. It's not good for the recording.
Oh, it's for the recording, of course. Oh my gosh. Okay. Cool. So you know what we'll do is I'm gonna give y'all a wine. You can pour and pass, and I'm gonna give y'all a wine at the end, and we can pour and pass. So I'm not trying to do all this at the same time. Okay. So. My name is Jaclyn Backhaus. I am known for falling asleep at parties. If you've ever been to a party with me, I've probably fallen asleep on your coat. And I'm okay with that. I've made peace with that. I think, you know, the fact is that I'm awake now. And that's all that counts. I made it to my own 5 minutes. And I'm relishing in my awakening, and I'm excited to craft for you tonight a moment of delight, and that will be my small contribution to the evening. I want you all to set, once you have a little bit of liquid in your cup, how's everyone doing? You're getting there? Okay. So once, we'll get our cups filled. And while we're doing that, I would love for you to set an intention for yourself. It can be an intention for this party. It can be an intention for your evening, for your weekend, for the autumn, for the end of the year. And I want you all to think on that intention now. Let's see. Maybe the intention is for you to turn your phone off more often. Maybe the intention is for you to revel in your presence. Shit. I started late. Okay, I skipped a thing. This is important. The intention you should set for yourself, it has to be highly, highly achievable. Highly achievable. Don't be like, I'm gonna run 10 miles every day. Like, no, it's an achievable intention. Mine is to stay awake through the rest of my performance. Another intention you could have is to compost this cup. The cups are compostable. Maybe your intention is to say hello to someone new. Maybe it's to be inspired by something you see tonight, by this room full of artists. Maybe it's to, your intention is to bask in some incredible newness. Maybe it's to ask someone where they got their shoes. Maybe it's to perfect your Irish exit. Maybe it's to leave the party with one new morsel of information about the world. Once you have your intention, whisper it into your cup. You can do that. Yeah, maybe we'll do it together, okay? Whisper your intention into your cup. My intention is to stay awake. Okay, now you can look into your cup and you can see the words and the letters in the words of your intention swirling around in your cup. They're inside the liquid. Now you can hold the cup up to this series of lights, and you can toast with me to the beauty of togetherness in all its small glories, to the whispered words that simmer in your cup. Now you can cheers them and drink them, and they'll live inside you.
Cheers.
Cool, that's it, thanks. Have a great prelude. When I show up to the party, I don't know what to expect. Every woman is beautiful, more beautiful than the last. I do not know if I am beautiful. I hear other people say it, but there is a part of me that never lets me believe it. When I see myself reflected, I always see a different face. I am 1,000 other women all at once. I am a shade of myself. This party is a beauty contest, and I feel I am an imposter, as I usually feel. And I feel their desperation, these beautiful women, their curiosity, their sorrow, their absolute utter boredom inside their lives to be stuck in such a time in history like this one. I heard about the last queen. We all did. Stunning, terrifying, a woman who bared her teeth, whose eyes were always darting. I heard she was 12 when she came here, that she painted all her walls red, blood red, and the king ordered them painted over again, and she painted them back, and that it continued for years like this. I heard about her last night. We all did. Because her crime is why we're here. It gave us our opening. The king told Vashti to dance. No, he told her to strip and then dance. Drunk the king into oblivion. He snores when he drinks, strangled sleep like a baby. Now I am thinking I don't want sons. It is too much responsibility. Maybe daughters, but then there is more pain. There is all of it. Vashti refuses that night. She changes the story. She says she won't do it. The king and his friends, they are laughing, and he is humiliated. He looks weak, first the walls and now this. He orders her removed or killed. What's the difference? Sent into obliteration. Did they have children, I am wondering? Do I, the new queen, become a stepmother? But there is no room for children in this story, their wonder or their ignorance. I do not want a child, but if I have my way, I will fill our palace with animals. Save them, carry them in my arms, and tuck them in at night. I ate kosher meat as a child, watching a chicken or lamb get carried off, the pain in their eyes, wishing for language we could understand.
I will not eat them again. If I am forced to in the grand dining hall, I will spit it in the folds of my dress, apologize to them later, the animals in my dreams who come and speak into my ears. I came to this party as a favor for my uncle who raised me when my parents died, who worries over our people, thinks something bad will happen as things tend to do for us. He will not bow to the king's right-hand man, so he is kicked on the street. Jews will not bow to anyone except God, and we do not kneel for anyone at all. I am haunted by images of our people kicked on the street, of a God who says, obey me, but survive first. If you are not alive, you cannot keep making more of you, of us. A man named Haman has built gallows for our people. He wants to hang us publicly in the street, cheer as our blood runs down the cobblestone. But I changed the story. Somehow the king chooses me, or maybe God chooses it, or maybe I do when all is said and done, and maybe there is no God, and maybe I am her. When we go to sleep at night, the king holds me like a child. He wraps his arms around me, and I wonder what love is, if it is anything like what I've been told, and if it is this sharpness in my chest that moves to my belly that makes me want to protect him, this man who is safer than anyone I know, whose skin is untouched by pain and moves innocent from one moment to the next. I whisper instructions into his ears at night. How can I endure to see the evil that shall come into my people? How can I endure? How many wives have moved armies, started wars, brought peace, executed the innocent, written novels, constructed and ended civilization by whispering into their husbands' ears? We don't want credit, I think. We want to live. No, we do want credit. Later in Poland, Jews were allowed to live because another king loved another beautiful Jewish woman. He named a castle after her, but I don't remember her name. And since she was beautiful, and since she was Jewish, and since she was human, he let the Jews live peacefully there for a long time until we all know what happened. The next king, the next ruler, the next war, the next public genocide, the next blood in the streets, and it all starts over again. I think about her and wonder if she whispered in his ear while he slept about her brothers and sisters, her mother, the way she baked her bread on Fridays, her father, his prayer shawl, and his hands over the Hebrew in his books, shaking, steady, morning, evening, and repeat. I'm thinking about when men first found me beautiful, how it changed things, how I try to find myself in their gaze, how I use it to my advantage, how it makes me lose myself inside it, the shades, and I wonder if it is knowing or if it is sex that protects us. On my holiday, it is mandated that we must drink so much we cannot tell good from evil. My mother once told me that a Jewish parent must teach her child to read and to swim. Lately, I've been thinking about how all stories are just recycled stories, that the myths we tell ourselves about the Garden of Eden were really about our fall from wildness, that the animism of everything that crossed our path from the direct communication and communion with animals and plants and the wind and the trees and a whole spiritual dimension we couldn't touch but we could feel, and how the garden trapped us all, and how we're in these collective myths we can't get out of, these recycled stories, but how much I love these stories, how they pull and change and shift and borrow and create, how all we really are is stories, a story we tell ourselves about who we believe we are and were and who we will be. And through that, we survive.
Get ready for the next track. Who's up next? Isaac Olga, I believe. Woo! Is that right? Am I right? Am I right? Anyone? Okay, very good, very good. You have shut up
now. Oh, thanks.
Is this on?
Yeah.
Is it? Okay, great. Hi.
Hi.
Just let me get mounted. It's easier coming down. All right, so I took the prompt quite literally and just planned a party. And I don't know, I think I missed my calling. You just, you, will you be the judge of that? I do hope you will come to my party. It's behind a waterfall. And the theme is time and futility and the film Fried Green Tomatoes. I'm gonna take your phones when you come in like Madonna. You'll get them on your way back out. There's seating, ample seating, too much seating, actually. It's a bunch of airplane rows and everyone gets their own. Or there's another room where great British bakers just defer to each other all around you. Or there's a third section where conversation happens on either side of you and your seat is Jon Snow's dick. And you must swivel to hear what each person is saying on either side of you. Everyone's very fabulous, but they bury the lead. It's a joy to discover where they've been and all that they've done. And everyone also has negative capability, which I think is essential. It's something Keats described as capable of being in uncertainties, mysteries, doubts, without any irritable reaching after fact and reason. And everybody chews very quietly. Margaret Atwood is there, and Phoebe Waller-Bridge, and Zadie Smith, and AOC. Music, Kim Cattrall scats. And then Joni Mitchell and Chaka Khan come on, not to sing their hits, but to sing the theme to Succession over and over again, with lyrics I wrote for the occasion. They were paid their rate. On the walls are Rothko's that vibrate and Golden's that shank you, and also some sections are just the holiday windows at Bergdorf's. Black and trans lives matter, and also there are seafood towers and carving stations and saltines with chocolate just frozen on them. Grain bowls, soft serve. There was a question about the oysters, but they are good. Everyone remembers meeting each other previously. Everyone is wrong, but they're okay with it. You know, they shut up and they learn from it. And everybody makes fun of that weird thing President Warren said the other day. The martini. The martinis are Arctic and only make everybody drunk enough to Amazon Prime a candle. But it doesn't take 2 days, it arrives immediately. And everybody lights it. And the prime delivery guy is actually Chris Evans. And he's got Tate's cookie crumbs in his chest hair. No one, I repeat, no one brings a guitar. But we do all sing. Everyone is into Disney an appropriate amount. Cholesterol is low and good fats are high. Babies are getting cochlear implants and Jeremy O'Harris is getting a text from Rihanna. And there are log flumes. And then we're in Spain. And we saw the La Sagrada Familia earlier and everybody salts the most perfect tomatoes. And we could really sit here all night and then someone clinks a fork against a glass and stands up and it's Mary Stuart Masterson, you know. Iggy herself, hoisting herself off a Jon Snow dick to talk about the fried green tomatoes they wanted to make, you know? A story about the unequivocally sexual love between two women. And everyone's crying because the fried green tomatoes they did make is pretty wonderful, but this sounds even more wonderful. Drag queens arrive and everyone gets a grant and... And Joan Didion says she's having a peculiar time. There are dogs, just dogs, and Aesop's soap in the bathroom, and Monday New York Times crosswords, and there's bacon, and a room where you can slap people who take selfies at the Holocaust and 9/11 memorials, and a moment of silence for Jesse Norman. And your grandmother is there and she's combing your hair, which is never something she did when she was alive, but she's doing it now and you know that it's her. And your niece, who was just born blind, opens her eyes and sees and smiles. And that person that you love is there, and the lights change and the waterfall stops and everyone else freezes, and you West Side Story dance at the gym with them. You have to do it, we teched it. And Trump is in prison, as are Barr and Giuliani and McConnell and Kushner and all the Trump kids, and his thoughts haunt him. And it is so nice to know where he is, which is prison, and know what he is capable of, which is nothing. It has been so long since you've just breathed, relaxed from trying to somehow protect everything from him with your tenseness. There's a room in which to do that. But come on back in, girl. There are gift bags.
Thank you, Isaac. That was wonderful. I'm good at that party. Hell yeah. Up next, we have the mysterious William Burke, I believe. William Burke is up next. Do we have William Burke? I'm gonna keep it going.
I'm what is up without me? Ask yourself and wonder. What are you doing in general? As you're gonna be. Are you as lost as you can be? Is this the only time you have to check in with me? Just kidding. Is this, I mean, fuck. Is this it? It can't be. Since I can only stay for 5 minutes. I want to give the care. Can we give the care? Can we just sit in a room and hold back the tears together and call it a and let people think it's an old-fashioned rager or shindig with whistling and or ponies while we cap it off without the fear of a failed or gathering or casual meeting or run-in or something by chance. If I change things about myself, like God in the back or in the front, or up on top, or something that will release us into the big time. When I think about the things I'm sorry, we got stuck. I bark. Feel bad for us. Although it happens. It shouldn't happen to us, but it's soon. There's that. I fall out and in love with the sound of the despairing rain of the people around. I fall when I shut the bathroom door. I forget what the sound people sound like when there is distress. I have compassion when I least expect, and none when it's needed, so there, let's throw on, and let's have a good cry in the now. And I, but listen, yeah, at least the baggage is colorful, and we don't go to the IHOP too much, and we're still in a room most of the time, and we're not committing ourselves to institutions in a regular fashion, and we're still be willing to dominate a conversation in a non-aggressive way. And let's not forget who opened the door and why we can't stop going to the gatherings you didn't want to go to but wanted to be invited to. And let's just live a little, and hopefully the breathe. Party won't stop.
Kate Tarker, and I love parties. Friends, Americans, fellow citizens of the world, I thought I was gonna be on a bigger stage. Here we are. In year 3 of Republican Party rule of this country. To quote writer Jennifer Wright, I never thought living through history would be this stupid. This might be year 3 of 4, or it might be year 3 of 8. Yeah, really let that sink in. Okay, year 3 of 8, it's possible. I don't know the future and you don't know it either, but we need to accept where we are. The first step of change is acceptance. This is true whether you're trying to quit cigarettes, negative self-talk, or a toxic partisan regime that is out to divide and conquer. So before I talk to you about my dream party, I would like us to collectively accept and acknowledge our current political, economic, social, racial, and environmental reality. If you could please repeat after me. None of us know what will happen in the future. But right now we are fucked. I look forward to the future with hope and enthusiasm. But right now we are fucked. I say super, you say fucked. Super.
Fucked.
Super.
Fucked.
Thank you. So now that we've accepted reality, what do we do with it? It's stressful, but stress is actually the first ingredient of a truly great party. I have learned this many times in my life. I learned this quite recently when I went through the bizarre stress of choosing wedding colors and seating charts and a life partner, Matt, but then followed that with the absolute joy of actually celebrating our wedding. I also learned it 2 years ago when I tried to skip throwing myself a birthday party. I thought, I'm a grown woman. I don't need birthday parties anymore. By afternoon, I found myself clutching my knees, curled up in the fetal position, staring hollow-eyed at a tombstone in Greenwood Cemetery. I got it together. It was fine. I had an emergency bowling party. But back to my theme, the worst of times demand the best of parties. I first learned how to party hard in college. My small liberal arts college was enormously taxing for most of the academic calendar. People lived in the library 24/7. Hygiene was something you could only find in the dictionary. We were malnutritioned, haggard, egg-headed. We had very few organized sports teams. We just studied all the time. But then for 3 days right before finals, we took off our clothes and drenched each other in cheap champagne and painted our tits blue and wore strange costumes and fake eyelashes. We fell in love on ecstasy and cut each other's bangs on mushrooms. We ate scorpions, some of us did anyway, or in my friend Liz's unfortunate case, a poisonous centipede bit her instead. And we danced and kissed and fucked each other in tents and in makeshift structures under the Portland, Oregon sky. It was fun, it was epic, it was Burning Man for babies. And so, like fools, we came back year after year, trading a full year of rigorous tedium and conference-style classes stuffed like pigs in a blanket with young libertarian mansplainers for 3 days of bonfires and glory. That's how oppressive institutions get you. At Reed, we called it Ren Fair, but in most of the world and throughout most of human history, this kind of party is called carnival. I love carnival. I love the history of it. I love the contemporary expression of it, which still exists all over the globe. It's rude, it's crude, it's collective, it's joyful, it's free titties, it's power to the people. It's a brief spell of harmony. Some would argue that escape valves like carnival or theater making or political protests actually only help to keep the dominant structure and power structure in place. That they're just distractions, that they loan us a tiny sliver of space in which to vent our aggression and frustration, only so that we may become obedient again for the rest of the year. Like the students of Reed College, who maybe actually needed a better work-life balance and 150 minutes of moderate to vigorous exercise per week, among other reforms. And sure, if I was given a choice between a world of systems that aren't broken in a broken world with great parties and great art, I would choose an unbroken world. But we don't really have that choice. The choice we have is to accept the struggle and hardship, but defy it with our joy. And we can find each other and make our burdens lighter together, because people can only sustain so much. Picture the year 1518, one of the most stressful and oppressive years of the Middle Ages. A weird thing called dancing mania pops up. People just can't stop dancing. In Strasbourg, a woman named Frau Trofia starts this outbreak, and soon more individuals get seized with a mysterious, undeniable urge to move. They join her. It's kind of like Footloose, if Footloose was an art house European movie with an unclear moral and an unhappy ending. People danced and danced and danced. They danced for days, for weeks, for months, until their legs broke, until they collapsed from exhaustion. In some cases, until they died. The town government tried to cure it by building a stage in the town square and having musicians play music. but it only made people dance longer and harder. Nearby, a group of people danced on a bridge until the bridge collapsed. What was the cause of this plague? At the time, people blamed neoliberalism. It's not true. They blamed demons. Neoliberalism is our problem now. But our best understanding is that they were just about as stressed out as people could be. People need to celebrate. I don't know if this country will survive. I don't know if there's enough that holds us together. I don't know if countries in general will survive. Maybe we'll find a better way of organizing. I don't know if our species will survive. As a group, you know, we've just never really put our minds together to try to figure out how to make that happen. I'd be curious to see what would happen if we tried, but we haven't yet, so no one knows the future. But my dream party is one where we keep showing up in rooms together, making room together and dreaming together, letting go of our divisions, healing our hearts, and stepping up. My dream party is any party. It is every party, it's this party, it's that party, it's a series of parties, but never a political party. Those are built to divide. My dream party is everyone and everywhere. My dream party is one that never stops. I say party, you say on. Oh, I did it wrong. Try that again. I say party, you say on. Party.
On.
Party.
On.
Party.
On.
Party.
On.
Party.
On.
A falafel with hot sauce and a side order of baba ganoush and a seltzer, please.
DJ, can I get a beat? I'm at a party at my apartment. This lesbian couple approaches me and they're like, "Oh my god, Paris!" And I'm like, "Oh my god, who are you?" They're like, "Don't you remember us? We met a few weeks ago on Fire Island. You were just kicked out for breaking into someone's house. You were breaking into all the houses, tripping on shrooms, only in a Speedo. Maybe you just needed a blanket. Maybe you just needed someone to hold on to. We walked you back to your hotel. When you got there and you walked through the gate, you shouted back, 'Thank God for lesbians.'"
I'm at another party named Redacted.
No sleep.
It's at a venue
bus.
Called Nowhere,
Not
Elsewhere,
club.
Somewhere,
club.
The Cock,
Plane.
The Hole,
no
the
sleep.
Pit of Desire,
no
Heaven,
club.
Hell,
club.
The Rosemont, Miss Mountrose,
no
The End,
bus.
The Beginning, The
Not
Inferno, The Sacrament, Poppy
Plane.
Juice. I'm wearing my mom's
pink
nightgown. The cover is $40, but a friend helped me get in. All of the men are shirtless and white and expensive looking. I think that their shirtlessness is toxically masculine. And then my friend gives me Molly, and I'm dressless.
A Donna Summer track is playing.
I'm feeling cathartic. Oh my god, I'm in love with you for 3 hours. Oh my God, we're all insecure. Oh my God, my mom is dead, but I'm living for her, hunty. Oh my God, I've been displacing myself as a white woman the entire night.
Tony.
Tilda.
Molly.
Drew. Winona. Kirsten.
Okay,
let's say Kirsten.
No.
Parker.
Posey.
You are Parker Posey.
I am
Parker Posey.
We are Parker Posey.
And by we, I mean me. Because we us are my pronouns.
I am the two people at the Transracial Summit. Rachel Dolezal and the black man who identifies as a white woman.
Did you see that documentary?
Yeah.
Crazy. My two selves reconcile their differences.
We make out.
We don't actually make out.
But we do make out with everyone else in the club. And by we, I mean me. Because we us are my pronouns.
Hey, Hannah slash Paris, you know what I'm thinking?
What, Paris slash Paris, Hannah?
I'm actually gonna look for my poppers. Wait, everybody, hold the performance. They're expensive. Okay, I found them.
Okay. You found
them?
Okay, amazing.
This was not rehearsed. That part. The rest was rehearsed. Okay. Oh, hey, here's the deal. Okay. Here's an impression. That's my mom, she's dead. So my therapist recently told me that I'm in a period of radical acceptance. Here's what that looks like. DJ, give me a beat!
Going to bed late, getting up early, eating my feelings, eating your ass, crying about my dad, crying about my mom. Crying about the future, crying about the past, crying and watching Romy and Michelle. Toy Story 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Forgetting where I am. Getting head in the middle of my room. Woo! His room, a party, a dance floor, a car, the street, anywhere you want.
So, I just decided that I'm a narcissist, and I think that's really cool. I came to this party for a reason. I came here looking for something. What? I came here searching. I came here longing. I came in a bathroom stall. Mazel. I come all the time. When I was a teenager, I used to come with wishes. The biggest three were, kill me please, kill me please. I want to be suffocated, destroy me. I want to become nothing. The second was, I want God to fuck me. I want the devil to fuck me. I want complete totality. The final one was, I want to become God. I want to give, be adored by all. How can I overthrow parties when I love to be seen by others? When I love myself, I'm a narcissist. I want to add narcissist to the alphabet. NLGBTQIA+++! I want to be noticed. I want to be held. I don't want to fear anymore. I don't want to cry anymore. I want to live. I want to live. My Venmo is at Paris. Text us. Save me!
Thanks for bringing me down before I get my head too. That was brilliant.